For those of you joining us online, welcome, and we hope you just stay with us each night of the week as we go through to Easter, wherever you're joining us from. We get to receive a message tonight by Reverend Vusi Vilakati. He is from Central District, and so he had to deal with the traffic all the way through Galilee's from Randburg, and we're really blessed to have him come through to Benoni to come and share with us. And so thank you, brother, for accepting the invitation and coming to share with us here at Northfield. I think it was in 2020, VC was part of our Lent journey, and at that time we could only do it online, and he was one of our guest speakers here at Northfield, but in an online space for our midweek Lent journey in 2020. But friends, as we gather for the start of this Holy Week, I'm going to invite you just to take a moment as we prepare ourselves for worship and to go on this journey. It flows from one day into the next. And so we don't see it as services. There's no benediction at the end. We just continue together week after week. And so let us pray together as we prepare our hearts. And so Jesus, we acknowledge the journey that you're on. We acknowledge that as we gather here tonight, we bring everything that we've discovered in the wilderness with you, and we lay it bare, and perhaps we are feeling a little bit raw as we go through all the emotion of this Holy Week with you. As we go through this journey, would your Spirit come and move within us, shape us, transform us, take us deeper into relationship with you, feel what you felt, experience what you experienced. Recognize who your Father is just as you recognized who your Father was. And so will you bless us as we gather now for worship and offer you songs in praise and prayers and listen to a message that is inspired by your Spirit. And so come, Holy Spirit, come. Will you move amongst us, we pray. Amen.
Good evening, church. Won't you stand as we praise our Savior King?
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness. Close, let your love surround.
Would you pray with me? So Father God, as we have gathered here this evening as your church, as your people, we pray that this week you'll do just that. This week won't just be a week where we'll gather more information, although we are so grateful for wisdom. But this will be a week where we feel drawn closer to your side. And as we journey with you step by step to that dreadful cross and to your victorious resurrection, that we will feel closer and closer to you each day. And this Holy Week won't just be another significant week in our life, but it will be a week that defines the rest of our life as we come closer and closer to our Savior King. And so we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will fill this room right now, and that you'll give us the courage to pray a brave prayer and ask you to fill our hearts, to minister to us. Jesus, as we gather here, we surrender our hearts to you. We surrender our lives to you again. We surrender anything that perhaps is stopping us from fully experiencing and fully accepting the gift of the beautiful cross. Jesus, we give you our pain and our questions, our wonderings and our sinfulness. And we ask in this moment as we vulnerably reveal our hearts to you, that you'll forgive us. We know, Lord Jesus, that we are just dust, and we are fragile and we are finite, but you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you love us with an everlasting kind of love. And so as we lay our brokenness and our sinfulness at the foot of your cross right now, we ask that your love will just surround us, as we have just sung, that you'll fill us and lift us up, so we may declare with the prophet Isaiah, that we may run but we'll never grow weary, that you'll lift us up with the eagles this week, that we may feel a new life and a renewal, that we'll feel strengthened as we draw closer to you. And so come, Holy Spirit, we pray. Won't you come and meet us as we worship you in vulnerability?
Oh, I once was lost.
church. Why don't you be seated as we welcome the Reverend Vusi to minister to us.
Good evening. That sounds a bit loud. Good evening to you all. Greetings to the colleagues here. And what a joy to minister with you tonight. And thank you to the resident ministers here and the team and the people of Northfield. Thank you for inviting me. What an honor and a privilege. It is a big gift to me. I hope there is a small gift towards you as well. Would you pray with me for a moment? Lord, turn our thoughts into prayers and turn our prayers into love and turn our love into a life lived with you. Even as we enter your passion this week. In the name of Christ and for his sake. Amen. I'm going to read just in a moment from John chapter 12. It seems it's the prescribed reading for this first day of Holy Week. But I want to just ask a question as we begin. And it's a question that's so common. And I'm not so sure whether you'll be loud enough for me to hear it, and I'll say it again for those that are in the audience at home. So what is love? What is love? Just words, throw words at me. What is love? Love is compassion. Love is unconditional. Love is patient. She's even citing the Bible. Love is action. Love is sacrifice. What is love? Love is a verb. Don't steal from my sermon. What else? Love is lekker, eh? Love is hope. Love is understanding. Why can't you give me just one definition of love and we can go home? So I come into the theme that you've set for this week as this is love. It would seem that the theme that you have set for the reflections and the way that you hope to journey towards the cross, as you even began with Palm Sunday yesterday, it seems that the theme is a search in one sense. It is a search for something that would help us identify how love looks like. It is a search that says somehow we hope we can see love when it takes form and shape and character. Just by the descriptions we've given today, it does say then there could be many parts to trying to understand this mystery, this deep, deep mystery we call love. And so you've taken such a very poignant and a very important theme and brought it into the center of the story of the passion of Christ and into that story of his death, his dying, his rising, and his life. All of the stuff you have stuck into that story, the theme of love. It is almost as I read the theme and I thought about it and I tried to run away from this commitment, and as I thought about it, I had the idea that you are searching for a way in which you would walk with this theme as your pathway into understanding the mystery of the cross even. And so my hope is that I will invite you into the story that we read today to just work with that and think together with that theme. So some people would say, love is a feeling. It is something that you feel and it feels good and it's a lovely feeling that you have inside you. Somebody once said to me, actually, love is a parent. When they wake up in the morning and they cook you a meal and you can feel the smell of the kitchen, it's the most beautiful feeling. Love is a parent. Somebody said, love is like a battlefield when you're struggling through stuff and then you come through and you conquer and it feels like yes. Somebody said, love is something you can't define, but when it's there, you know it. Could that be true for many other things? Richard Rohr speaks of love in this manner. He says, love is not really an action that you do. Love is what you are, who you are, and your essence in the deepest sense. So he almost speaks of love as at the heart of the human identity. That if you drop everything about what God created you to be, the purity of your sense of your vocation as a human being is to be love and become love and be love in every way possible. Can I read the Bible now? So I want to read from John chapter 12, and I'll read the first 8 verses. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given to Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those who were reclining at the table with him. Then Mary took about a pint of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with fragrance of the perfume. But one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray Jesus, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she should save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. This is the gospel of Christ, and thanks be to God. Amen. So allow me to draw just 3 points. Isn't that what we're supposed to do as Methodist preachers? 3 points, eh? The first thing I want to just hold out for us as we try to reflect on the theme of love is that it is 6 days before Passover, and a dinner is set for Lazarus, for Jesus. And at the dinner, there's Lazarus. I want you to imagine the scene. 6 days in the context of a very tense week. The smell and the aroma of death is already in the air. Jesus can almost feel that my life this week might actually come to an end. And as he feels that, and as all of those emotions about the passion and the pain that is, you know, going to unfold in this week, she is beginning to have premonitions about what's going to transpire. As he feels that, then there is a dinner that's set for him. So understand the context. There is a looming sense of death, and then there is a sense that some people in the crowd decide, before something happens to him, let's pull him aside and prepare dinner for him. So, this is love. I think one of the first acts that we see in the Passion story is the deep hospitality of loved ones. When you're going through painful moments, as Jesus faces the cross, there is people that decide, we're going to extend one more act of love towards him, and we're going to do a dinner for him, a dinner in his honor. So somehow it says that in this very painful moment, sometimes the deepest gift that shows us how love looks like, it is the acts of genuine care and hospitality of friends and loved ones. I think you can resonate with this story. The moment when you were in a crisis, and then there's the friend that phones you in the morning, and maybe you are going to attend to a very important incident in your life, and then they phone you in the morning, can I have coffee with you before you go to that moment? Understand that moment? When somebody says, can I be just one act of hospitality and care and compassion? Part of the invitation of this week is the invitation to juxtapose themes. When there is hatred, let me be love. When there seems to be a looming sense of death, let me show hospitality. When there is a theme that's running and rallying the world around, let's choose to be the alternative to what is happening around us. So that's my first point. That we live with people that live the passion of the cross every day. People that are going through crucibles of pain and suffering in each and every corner of our lives. And as those people live through those things, the gift that we can give as the church is to become those agents of radical hospitality that says, we care. We can see through your pain. We can see what you're going through. We want to sit with you. We want to make a dinner just in your honor. Can you imagine a church that's always setting up a dinner for the vulnerable, for the suffering, for the pained, for the lost, for the depressed, for the one that's going through a relationship crisis, for all of those? A dinner of radical hospitality. When death is looming in the air, who do you choose to be? And what do you choose to be? And that defines what love looks like. How does love look like in Holy Week? It is radical, genuine care and hospitality and compassion and looking into the faces of the people that are around us. That's the first thing that happens in this text. But can you imagine? Can you imagine how the writer is so crafty in the way they write this? Lazarus, who was dead, now is alive, is also at the table. Just think of Jesus turning to Lazarus and saying, hey, Lazarus, how was it down there? Can you imagine that, eh? So the writer is playing out that actually we are dealing, the church deals in the space between life and death. The church lives in this fine margin between life and death. We sit in the same table with people that have faced death so many ways. We understand this. We've just come out of COVID. We understand what it means to live with death in our midst. But in truth, think of not the physical forms of death. Think of the small deaths that people are going through around us. And what does it mean to be a church that's attentive enough to the person's story? Because that's what Martha and Mary were attentive to. They could see some deep movements shift in the politics of Jesus' death, in the politics that were part of the story of Holy Week. They could touch everything else. They didn't get absorbed by the politics around Jesus' death. They chose to focus on Jesus and offer him ounces of care and hospitality and love. May we be a church that's attentive to people, to stories. A church that seems when there is a story of pain, we become the alternative to that story. When there is a story of depression, we become the alternative to that story. When there is a story of struggle, we become an alternative and offer an alternative to that. When there's a story of death, we become a fragrance of hospitality and life. Secondly, in this story, there is what Mfundisi spoke about, love. This is love. Love is a verb. Somebody said it there, and he also said it's an action. So there's a number of critical verbs in this text, and they are all stacked up in verse 3, if I'm not mistaken. Verse 3. So in the dinner, as the joy of the dinner is flowing, as this moment of honoring Jesus for the last time, they don't know what will happen in the next few days, but let's just honor him. Let's just focus on him. Let's just pamper him. Let's just be with him. That which they did will carry him into the week. As he is insulted, as everything happens in the week, he will remember, I have people that love me. You remember what John 11 says? Jesus knew he was loved by Lazarus and Martha and Mary, and he also loved them. He cried at Lazarus' tomb, you know? So as he walks through the week, the things you do for people, the loving acts that you do for people, they echo deeper in the moments of suffering. They echo deeper in their lives. They remember them, and they carry them through even the most difficult patches of their life. As we walk into this Passion Week, let's be attentive to the stories. Then there's the verbs that are here. So Mary stood up, and as Mary stood up from the table, Mary took. Eh? Mary poured the expensive perfume, eh? And Mary wiped. It's almost like a juxtaposition of chapter 13 where Jesus does the same thing, stands up, picks up a basin, isn't it? It's almost a juxtaposition that there's a sacrament that's happening right here in this moment. Somehow, what is love? This is love. When we take deliberate action to really do the acts that change the world. Love is the actions that we take. In this case, Mary took this bottle, and as she took it, she opened it, and as she opened it, she poured it out, and as she poured it out, she then even reached down in an act of worship to wipe the feet. I don't know, in some of the churches I grew up in, people have a nice tendency of sending Jesus to the world. In their prayers, they would say, Jesus, we pray that you go to those that are in hospital. We pray that you go to those that are sick. We pray that you go and be. And they send Jesus to all the places, but they never move to those places. That's not Northfield, eh? It's the churches I grew up in, the churches I've known. You don't pray those prayers here. I don't think you are the people that pray those prayers, do you? But there's something about action that makes things come alive. Action does a number of things. Amongst the things that action does, you know, when you think of love as something you possess, love is only seen in motion. Love is only seen in motion. The God that we worship, the Trinity that we worship, the Trinity that we are created in the image of, is an act of love that's always pouring itself to each other. The Father pouring God's self to the Son pouring God's self to the Spirit. And there is a constant and a dynamic movement and flow of energy between the Father and the Son and And all of that in the Godhead, in the God self, in the God creative force, comes so many gifts. It comes the God that creates and unfails the world into being. It comes the God that rescues the world. Comes the God that nurtures the world. Even if our actions don't do anything, but if our actions are to be about, we want to be a creative force for good, that our actions are going to stand in the world in the heart of Holy Week and become a force of change for good and creativity and thinking about how can we be part of changing the world in this moment and in this time. And if you want to be like Jesus, you want to be the person that wants to say, how can we save this world? Kaylee, when she preached yesterday, she spoke about save us now. And that thing, the saving act, those actions that save things and save people and touch people's lives with real difference. That love that nurtures with wiping feet with care and gentleness. Your acts of love, your acts of gentleness, your acts of coming alongside people change the world. People say, it could be Richard Rohr that writes this, that people are changed by two things. People are changed and transformed by love and by suffering. Because they all have an ability to open us up to something. They open us to the reality that what is here is not enough. And when pain comes, it opens us to the need for change. When love comes, it invites us to become more. And so as a church, we sit with this gift of love that we are talking about tonight. Can we become those people that says, for those that are loved, let's become a conduit of deeper love. For those that are in suffering, let's become part of the transformative force that brings them back to life. So when I was at college, some many, many moons ago, we used to do clinical pastoral care. And we would go to Pretoria Hospital. And we would get there and the chaplain, Dr. Delapu, if not mistaken, and he would make us go and talk to patients. And when we talk to patients, and we would ask, so what do we talk about when we talk to the patients? And we would say, can we talk to the patients about, can we talk about God? Can we talk about theology? Can we talk about suffering? Or can we talk about anything? He says, no, just go there. And listen. And listen to the themes that they talk about more. And as we did those reflections and verbatims that we would do, have to do after those moments, one of the things that they would say, most people would say, when people lie on the hospital bed, they're not looking for theology. They're not looking for a theory of love. They're not looking for all of the clever things that the church has to say. They're looking to somebody in order to listen to their story. And the stories that they'll talk about would be the love they received from their mother or father or somebody. They'll talk about the love that they'd received in their life, or the love that they had lacked and they had not received, or the love they had not given or had not been given. They'll talk about family. They'll talk about things, about meaning and purpose. They'll talk about those things, and those things are the substance of what love is about. If there is anything that shows us and gives character to love, it's those minute daily experiences of connecting with another individual, a human being, listening to their story between them and their daughter, a father and a son, a sister and a brother, and the crucibles of how they are really trying to make love happen in life. Somebody once said, you know, the people that are healthier in life are those that have receive both conditional and unconditional love. Because when you are young and you are growing up and the family is able to afford you both those gifts, you become better as a human being. If it only affords you unconditional love, you never know about the other. If they only afford you conditional love, you never know about the other. If you have a both that mix, you become healthier as a person. And somehow the gift of the church is to understand the gift that we have and we can give to the world. And lastly, then when the dinner had been set, the hospitality, when love had been in action, then that bottle that was opened, when it was poured on Jesus' feet, the fragrance of that moved across the whole house. The whole space was filled. So the small act that you do in a corner reverberates across many other spaces. The small gift of generosity and kindness you do in this corner becomes a fragrance of hope against many other spaces. And you are the gift that you can give to all of those people around you. Because you are called to be the fragrance of love and hope, of compassion and hospitality. And that fragrance is contained in the small actions you do each and every day. May God bless you. In the name of Christ and for his sake. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing? Church, as we go from this place, may we remember that Christ loved us so much that he didn't just sit idly by, but he acted. He showed us that love was a verb by coming to earth. And as we leave from this place and continue this journey this week, may we not send Jesus into the world, but may we go out now as his hands and feet to show people his love and his kindness and his hospitality. We so look forward to seeing you as we continue our journey tomorrow. Amen.